So people should try and prepare early and have a bath, put on your best clothes, use miswak, use some itar and come to the masjid early. And whosoever recites durood upon the Prophet or salat upon the Prophet once and says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad or sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then Allah sends 10 blessings upon that person. But in the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because the community in Medina grew and spread, and so Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu introduced a second adhan. Allah says, Fas'au ila zikrillah. Come running to the remembrance of Allah. And here the mufassirin are in unanimous agreement. Zikrillah here implies khutbah. And never ever throughout their lives is there even a single incident being reported in any book of hadith with sahih or weak narration in which a khutbah was given in anything but Arabic. My dear brothers and respected elders, with Allah's fazl and mercy, He has given us the best of everything. He has given us the best of the books, the best of the prophets, the best of the deens, and the best of the days. The best of the nights, the best of the houses. Allah has made us in the ummah of His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most noble of His prophets, given us His kalam, khayrul kalami kalamullah. And Allah has given us the best of the deens, deen of Islam. Allah has given us Makkatul Mukarramah, Baytullah, and Madinatul Munawwara. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prayed, Allahumma ja'al bil madinati da'ifai ma ja'alta min al barakati bi Makkah. Ya Allah, whatever barakah you put in Makkah, whatever barakah you put in Makkah, put twice as much in Medina. Allah has given us the best of the days. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, khayru yawmin tala'at alayhi shamsu yawmul jumu'ah. The best of the days upon which the sun shone is the day of Jumu'ah. This is the day Allah created Adam alayhi salam. This is the day He was admitted into Jannah, and this is the day He was taken out. And when Qiyamah shall occur, it will also be a day of Jumu'ah. The Christians, they chose Sunday. The Jews chose Saturday, and Allah reserved Friday for the Ummah of His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And especially on this day, along with other occasions, Allah has blessed this ummah. Inna fil jumu'ati la sa'atun la yuwafiquha 'abdun muslimun yas'alu Allah khayran illa a'tahu iyyahu. On the day of Jumu'ah, there is a special moment, and Allah has kept that a secret. And whenever any Muslim asks Allah for anything good, yas'alu Allah khayran illa a'tahu iyyahu, that Allah grants him whatever he has asked. And Allah has kept that a secret. Many of the mashayikh and the pious ancestors, they used to consider this to be in between Jumu'ah, the khutbah, or in between the two khutbahs, and in between the khutbah and the salah, or immediately after salat, or sometimes after asr. But on the day of Jumu'ah, there is definitely a sa'ah, a time, a moment. Whatever dua a person makes, Allah acknowledges and accepts that dua. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged the Muslims and the believers to do many things on the day of Jumu'ah. To give it the importance that the day of Jumu'ah deserves. Many people take Jumu'ah very lightly. Many people take Jumu'ah very lightly. There are other prayers, the usual prayers we can pray anywhere. One of the things Allah has blessed this ummah with, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَجُعِلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَتَهُورًا. And the Prophet said, Allah has made the whole world, the whole earth, a clean place for me to pray. Wherever the time comes, if a person can't get to the masjid, then he can offer his prayer anywhere that he may find himself. And along with other prayers as well, we are encouraged to pray in the masjid. وَرْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. We should pray with the people who pray and try and get to the masjid. Because a prayer prayed in the masjid deserves and is worth much more than what a person can ever pray at home or anywhere else. But other prayers Or it is permissible if a person for whatever reason can't get to the masjid, then he can pray at home or at his business or at his farm or in the mountains or jungle or wherever he may be. But for people who are resident at home and are healthy and grown up, and for men it is obligatory to come and pray their Jummah Salat with the congregation in masajid where Jummah takes place. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith has been reported to have said, "Man taraka thalathu jumu'in tahawunan," whosoever neglects three jumu'ahs, either casually by looking down upon or not giving jumu'ah the importance that it deserves, or lazily simply can't be bothered, illa taba'a Allahu ala qalbi. If a person neglects three jumu'ahs out of laziness, he can't be bothered, then Allah will seal his heart. In another hadith it is mentioned that people should stop missing their jumu'ahs. لِيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ أَوْ وَضِعِهِمُ الْجُمُعَاتِ أَوْ لِيَخْتَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَلَا يَكُونُنَّ مِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. People should stop missing and neglecting the Jummah Salat, otherwise Allah will seal their hearts and they will find themselves among the ghafileen, among the negligent, and then they will lose importance for Deen and Islam and their hearts will become sealed. Jummah is very, very important for Muslims. Allah has given a special command in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu, and Allah has revealed a special surah upon Jummah. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu, idha nudiya lis-salati min yawm al-jum'ah, fas'au ila zikrillah. Oh, you believers, when you are called on the day of Jummah, for salah, idha nudiya lis-salah, when you are called for salah, fas'au, come running towards the zikrullah, come running towards Allah's remembrance. Wazarul bay', and when you are called, when the adhan is said for Jummah, then leave whatever you are doing, your businesses and your affairs, leave them. And even though they may be halal, legitimate sources of income, but on the day of Jummah, when the adhan for Jummah is called, then leave everything. فَسْعُوا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ ذَٰلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. This is surely definitely better for you if only you were to know. If only you knew. And in the time of Sahaba and the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people would start to pray, to prepare and start coming to the masjid early in the morning. And when the day of Jummah sets in, and then there Allah appoints, Allah sends angels, they stand by the gate of the masjid and they start recording and taking register, as it were. As when people are in schools or colleges, then the teacher takes a register and the angels record who's attending. The first person who comes for Yawmul Jumu'ah and for Salatul Jumu'ah, he's given the reward as though he slaughtered a camel. Wow. Then the next person as though he slaughtered a cow. Then the next person as though he slaughtered a goat. Then the next person as though he slaughtered a chicken. And then as though the next person will get the reward of someone who gives an egg for sadaqah. And then the reward decreases until the imam, when he stands to deliver khutbah, then the angels also close the register. And so anybody who comes afterwards, as though he will be marked absent, he finds himself missing. And then Allahu Akbar, then the angels, they stop. And they also listen to the khutbah which the imam recites. Although some ulama are of the opinion, in light of a hadith, man adraka raka'atan faqad adraka salah, whosoever finds one rakat of a salah. And he says in hadith, man adraka ruku'a faqad adraka raka'a, whosoever obtains a ruku' in any rakat, then he as though he obtains that rakat. And whosoever obtains one rakat in any salat, in jamaat, then it's as though he will be given the reward of that salah. So if a person comes late even for Jummah, but he's able to get the ruku' of the second rakat, then as though he will be given, he's regarded as someone who's participated in Yawmul Jummah, and for him it will be sufficient. Other ulama have another opinion that as long as a person joins the salah before the imam makes salam, then it is sufficient. But in light of the first hadith, whosoever finds the ruku will find rak'at, and whosoever finds the rak'at as though he finds the whole salat. So whosoever finds ruku of the second rak'at when the imam is praying, then for him as though Jum'ah has been completed, and he gets the reward of Jum'ah. And anyone who finds comes in late, then although he completes the two rak'at, but then he should pray Zuhr Salat, the full four rak'at, because he didn't get any reward, because he did not get any rak'at, so as though he did not get the prayer, as though he was not part of Jum'ah. Samajari? So Jum'ah is very, very important. And Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhi majma'in, on the day of Jumu'ah, they will leave their homes early. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged people, مَنِ اغْتَسَلَ يَوْمُ الْجُمُعَةِ, and that a person, he should have a bath on the day of Jumu'ah. ثُمَّ لَبِسَ مِنْ أَحْسَنِ ثِيَابِهِ, and then a person should put on his best clothes. وَمَسَّ مِنْ طِيبٍ, and also make use of fragrance, عِتَر, musk. Allahu Akbar. Then he comes to the masjid and he doesn't jump over the shoulders of people. And then he prays whatever, at least two rakat. And then he joins the salat, listens to the khutbah and prays his salat. Then whatever sins he's committed from the previous Jummah to this, and then this becomes a compensation for his sins. From one Jummah to the next. Allahu Akbar. And Muslims have also been encouraged to recite Suratul Kahf on the day of Jumu'ah. And it says in hadith as well, whosoever recites Suratul Kahf on the day of Jumu'ah, and every Jumu'ah he's in the habit of reciting this surah, then this surah becomes a compensation for the sins from one Jumu'ah to the next Jumu'ah. Allahu Akbar. So people should try and prepare early and have a bath, put on your best clothes, use miswak, use some itar, and come to the masjid early. And Allah gives tawfiq, and people should recite Surah Kahf. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, فَأَكْثِرُوا عَلَيَّ فِيهِ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ, and on the day of Jumu'ah, people should try and recite as much salat upon the Prophet as they can, as much darood upon the Prophet as they can. Salat upon the Prophet, مَنْ صَلَّ عَلَيَّ مَرَّةً صَلَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهَا بِعَشَرَةً, and whosoever recites darood upon the Prophet or salat upon the Prophet once, and says Allahumma salli ala Muhammad or sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then Allah sends 10 blessings upon that person. So salat upon the Prophet is a very special amal. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allah himself and his angels, they send rahmat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the angels, when they send rahmat, in other words, they pray to Allah. Rahmat is Allah's mercy. Allah sends it. So when angels send it, that means they pray to Allah. Ya Allah, have mercy and send barakah upon your beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when we send salat, we also say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Oh Allah, you send your rahmat and your blessings and your fazl upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family, his followers, as you have been sending mercy upon Ibrahim and his followers and his children and his generation. Innaka hamidun majid, as you are all praiseworthy and all glorious. When people come to the masjid on the day of Jumu'ah, obviously like any other time, whenever people come, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged people that when people come, that they should read two rakat before sitting down. This is known as Tahiyyatul Masjid. According to some imma, when it comes, it's important. According to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmahullah, it's a desirable and mustahab, but nevertheless a sunnah and a preferred sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if a person happens to sit down before saying his two rakat, then the time for Tahiyyatul Masjid has lapsed. And similarly, on the day of Jumu'ah, when a person comes, on the day of Jumu'ah, the first thing which is obligatory is the first azan. In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there used to be only one azan for Jumu'ah. And people would come before that, they would already be in the masjid mostly, and anybody who hadn't come, when they would hear azan, they would rush to the masjid, leave everything, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would start his khutbah. But in the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because the community in Medina grew and spread, and so Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu introduced a second azan. And the first azan used to take place And then people would be given time to pray rakatain or sunnah. And there is a difference of opinion amongst ulama. In one hadith it is stated in Tabarani that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this hadith has been reported by Ibn Abbas, كَانَ يُسَلِّي أَرْبَعًا قَبْلَ الْجُمْهَةِ وَأَرْبَعًا بَعْدَحَا, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pray 4 rakats before Jumu'ah and 4 rakats afterwards. And there is a hadith in Muslim as well, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged people to pray 4 rakats after Jumu'ah. And then in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been reported to pray another 2 rakats when he would go home. So some imma give tatbiq to all these riwayats. So you pray 4 first, then another 4, and then another 2, then that will incorporate all the hadiths. Some people only pray 2 before and 2 afterwards, because there are hadiths in which it is mentioned 2 rak'atain before Jumu'ah, rak'atain ba'd al-Jumu'ah. But in other hadiths, 4 rak'ats before Jumu'ah, 4 rak'ats after Jumu'ah, and then another 2 rak'ats. So if a person does this way, then all the ahadiths will be incorporated. But if and then the second azan is said, and then after the second azan, the imam stands to give khutbah. And when the imam stands to give khutbah, then even the angels stop everything, and then they come and they listen to the khutbah of the imam. Some people, they consider khutbah to be like a wa'z, like advice, like nasiha. And although that is the case, but the fundamental and primary status of khutbah is zikrullah. As Allah mentions in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu iza nudiya lis-salah. Everybody comes to Jumu'ah for prayer, but Allah says, Fas'au ila zikrillah. When you are called for prayer, then come running to zikrullah. Come running to the remembrance of Allah. Although prayer will take place, and prayer is obligatory, but Allah doesn't say, Fas'au ila salah, Fas'au ila al-ibadah. Allah says, Fas'au ila zikrillah. Come running to the remembrance of Allah. And here the mufassirin are in unanimous agreement, zikrillah here implies khutbah. So people should try and get to the masjid before the khutbah starts. And once the khutbah starts, then إِذَا خَرَجَ الْإِمَامُ فَلَا صَلَاةَ وَلَا كَلَامَ. And when imam stands to give khutbah, then there is no prayer and there is no kalam. If a person is doing something inappropriate for another person to say insit, فَقَدْ لَغَى. It's not even permissible for someone to stop somebody else from doing something inappropriate. If someone is talking, someone doing something else, and another person says, don't do this, brother, even that is not permissible. Because when the imam stands to give khutbah, then everybody must give their full attention to the imam and listen to him attentively. Even the angels who are recording the presence, whoever is coming in, even they stop, they close their sahifa, and they also come and listen to the khutbah. And according to many ulama, there is no even salat. If a person comes and the imam is giving khutbah, then they should just sit down and they should listen. Some ulama are of the opinion that if a person hasn't prayed, then he should pray 2 rakats, and the dalil is taken from the amal of his habib Sulayk radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he once he came to the masjid, sat down, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had mounted the minbar. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw him, he asked him, have you prayed 2 rakat? And he said no. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then stand and pray 2 rakat. And while he remained praying, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam qa'ada ala al-minbar. The Prophet did not start khutbah, and the Prophet remained sitting upon the minbar and allowed him to finish his 2 rakat. And sahaba, they say, this was a special incident because Sulayk radiallahu anhu was a very, very poor man, and his poverty was evident from his clothes. He was wearing very tatty clothes. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then after the salah wanted to encourage people to help him and to give him charity, and this is why he asked them to stand and pray, because if the Prophet picked them out from the congregation and said, have you prayed, then obviously everybody's attention would have been at him. Yes. And so everybody saw what he was like. And when after the salah, then the Prophet encouraged people to give him sadaqah, so it shows the real intention why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded him to pray then, was to attract the attention of people towards him, so that they would be encouraged to help their brother and to help a person in need. Otherwise, the general practice of the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in was, whenever the Imam would have started, then nobody used to say their prayer afterwards. And then once the khutbah starts, in many parts of the world, although in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khutbah was the main. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's khutbah used to be brief. When he would pray, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Jumu'ah salat, often he would recite first rakat, سَبَّحِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْعَلَىٰ, second rakat, حَلَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ الْغَاشِيَةِ. And it doesn't take very long and to recite his salat with these two surahs. And the Prophet's khutbah would be shorter than his salah. And in fact, in hadith it is mentioned, keep your khutbah short and prolong your salah. And so the salat is longer than the khutbah. And the khutbah, if the salat of the Prophet was short, then you can imagine how short his khutbah used to be. And it is recommended that in the khutbah begins with a praise of Allah. And ulama have stated that in khutbah there are two main things. One is for the time of Zuhr Salat to have set in. It is not permissible to give khutbah of Jumu'ah before the waqt and before the time for Jumu'ah sets in. And so main thing is time, and the second thing is Zikrullah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not specified how much time or how much zikr should be in the khutbah. But from his amal, from his practice, the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give khutbah, and the way Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in and the Khulafa Rashideen continued giving khutbah after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the khutbah begins with praise of Allah, and then there is shahadatain, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, or nashadu an la ilaha illallah wa nashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Then there is some nasiha, there is some hadith, some verse from the Quran, which incorporates nasiha, and there is at the same time in the second khutbah there is dua for the believers, the khutbah to be divided into two parts, for the khatib to sit in between two parts. These are all part and parcel of the sunnah of khutbah. But the main thing about khutbah is that it is zikrullah. And the fact that there is nasiha, but that doesn't mean that the fundamental identity of the khutbah is wa'ad. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his time, many non-Arabs used to come to Madinatul Munawwara, and then Sahaba, when they spread out far and wide to different parts of the world, and the people did not used to understand Arabic, and the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, never ever throughout their lives is there even a single incident being reported in any book of hadith with sahih or weak narration in which a khutbah was given in anything but Arabic. Just as our salat is prayed only in Arabic. Somebody, even though a new Muslim, he doesn't know how to recite Arabic. If he learns the meaning of Surah Fatiha, okay, in the very, very beginning, he doesn't know anything, so he could be excused, but you can't continue praying in English. You have to pray in Arabic. And the Quran has to be recited in Arabic. Similarly, khutbah was given throughout the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only in Arabic. So if the purpose was to provide nasiha on the day of Jumu'ah when people are gathered, then for the benefit of the people who would come to Madinatul Munawwara as new Muslims, and when Sahaba went out far and wide and the people did not understand Arabic, okay, perhaps the Sahaba who would lead the people in Salat, they didn't know the native language, but never ever was there even a single incident reported in which any translation of the khutbah ever took place. And now in many places, in different parts of the world, for example in the Indian subcontinent, when Jumu'ah is prayed, like the way we do it here, we do... Initially there's a bayan, and then there's adhan. People are given time for sunnah, then the second adhan, and then there is khutbah and so on, and then there is completion of salah. Many people they think, oh, it's bid'ah to give bayan in any other language before the khutbah. And in many cases, what people do, they sit around, and then when the khutbah begins, they do a small part in Arabic, and then the rest of the khutbah is in English. Well, if this is bid'ah, then why is that not bid'ah? Because in fact, that is a worse bid'ah than the other one, because in the second instance in which the khutbah is briefly in English and the rest is briefly in Arabic, and then the rest in English, that is a worse bid'ah than the other one, because in this case, one is distorting and corrupting the practice of the Sahaba and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In here, in which there is a bayan, because nowadays people, they are focused on their watches and times. People have set times for everything. They want to come in. They know many people are working, taking time off college or work and coming to the masjid on time. And they, because the times are advertised, and so then khutbah takes place. And in the meantime, there are people, and it's an opportunity to give people nasiha, because nowadays, unfortunately, people don't come to masjid. People don't listen to sermons. People don't bother learning deen. So, to accommodate that, in some parts of the world, particularly in the Indian subcontinent, until recently, and the ulama used to give bayans or lectures after Juma Salat. Shah Ismail Shaheed Rahimahullah, who was one of the grand ulama a couple of hundred years ago in the Indian subcontinent, it was his practice on the day of Juma, Adhan would be called, khutbah would be given in Arabic, and then the Salat would be prayed, and anybody who wanted to stay after the Salat, then there would be a lecture or a nasiha after Salatul Jumu'ah. In many Tablighi Marakis, for example, this Sunnah is still followed. And the Sunnah of only doing khutbah in Arabic, and then the Salat, and then they want to encourage people, and then they pray, and then they give a lecture after the prayer. But nowadays, in many masajid, there is a bayan in English, or the local language before the actual khutbah, and people say, oh brother, this is bid'ah. And but then the same people, what they do, colleges, university and other places, they do a very brief khutbah in Arabic and then the rest in English and in other language. That is also not sunnah. Because if they leave one practice, they say bid'ah, so is the other one. And the other one is worse than the previous one, because in the previous one, they don't regard it as a part of khutbah. But in the second instance, to say it in English is clearly against the practice of the Prophet and Sahaba, but it is regarded acceptable. That is not the case. If people think that it is permissible, waaz and nasiha for people to understand, khutbah is zikrullah, but the Quran is nasiha. In huwa illa zikra lil alameen. As Allah says in the Quran, this is a reminder, this is a warning, this is tabligh for all the people of the world. But we don't recite Quran in English or in Urdu or Somalian or any other language. We recite Quran in Arabic. We listen and we read translations. But that is not the same as Quran. Quran is in Arabic. As Allah has revealed it, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. And ulama have stated, because every language has its special influence and special effect. Arabic is the language of Quran, language of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it will be the language of Jannah. So Allah wants Muslims to keep their association with the language of Arabic, with the language of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In many other languages of the world, they lack that respect and appreciation for elders and for goodness. In English, everyone is you, whether you're a child, whether you are a man or a woman, or a young or an old, respectable, unrespectable person. But in many Islamic languages, there's different ways to address elders, to address youngsters, and to address people with respect, usually in the plural form. So Allah wants us to maintain our ties with our history. And ulama has stated, in fact, it is faradul kifaya upon every community that there should be people who understand Arabic. If there is nobody in the community who understands Arabic, then the whole community will be sinful. Because the Quran is in Arabic. Because sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are in Arabic. So if people don't understand the original source, It's an obligation upon us. Then the whole community will be sinful. But even if a few people understand Arabic properly, enough to understand Quran and Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then that obligation will be relieved on behalf of the whole community and will suffice. But if not enough people understand for it to be sufficient for the community, then the whole community will be sinful. So real khutbah is in Arabic. And Allahu Akbar. But because of fitna and fasad, many people, Allahu Akbar, don't understand issues of the things. I'm very, very quick to point out and fingers at others, but don't look at their own amal. So Jummah is a very, very important time for Muslims as communities, and something that people should not take lightly. And as we said earlier, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged people that they should prepare their best and have a bath, use miswak, use itar, come to salat early, come and say salat upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, read Surah Kahf, come to your prayers early, and when the khutbah starts, then everybody should listen attentively, whether they understand or they don't understand. May Allah Rabbul Alameen have mercy upon us and enable us to understand.